So far, we've looked at what could be total fabrications of an abductor. Now I'm going to come on to another claimed sighting of an abductor carrying away a child on the evening of the 3rd of May by members of an Irish family, the Smiths. This is considered so crucial that Scotland Yard put this sighting at the very centre of their investigation into Madeleine's disappearance. I'm calling him Smith Man. Less than 5 weeks after Madeleine's reported disappearance, and soon after Jerry McCann made his announcement to the world about a man seen on the 3rd of May who might have been carrying a child, the Drogheda Independent first broke the news that there had been a second apparent sighting of a man carrying a child that night. Members of an Irish family, the Smiths, from Drogheda, headed by grandfather Martin Smith, had apparently informed the Garda, the Irish police, who in turn informed the Portuguese police, that they had seen a man walking down towards the beach in Praia da Luz at about 10 p.m. the night Madeleine vanished, apparently after they had all come out of Kelly's bar. Further coverage of Martin Smith followed in other newspapers. His photo was published in one of them, and references were made to him knowing Robert Murat well. Smith was so upset by these references to Murat that he took legal action against the newspaper. I mentioned Martin Smith briefly in my recent film about Madeleine, buried by mainstream media. In my film, I described Martin Smith and Murat as friends. Some days after I published my film, I received an email purporting to be from Martin Smith. His email was short and to the point. It said, "Dear Mr. Hall, I have just watched the four parts of your new film, Buried by Mainstream Media, etc., which I found very interesting. I would like to point out a major inaccuracy near the end of part 4 of the film, where it was stated that I was friends with Robert Murat. This statement is untrue, and I would like it corrected. I had come across Mr. Murat twice in the previous 12 months, had never been introduced to him, and merely knew him by sight. Yours sincerely, Martin Smith." I asked him to verify his identity, and he sent me an image of what he said was his current driving license. I am happy to accept this, that he and Murat were not friends. In my email reply to Martin Smith, I asked him for an interview, but he declined. Nine of the family were on holiday there on the day Madeleine was reported missing. Martin Smith claimed that they saw a man carrying an infant girl walking down the Rua da Escola Primaria around 10 p.m. His statement in the police files said, "As he reached the main road, he crossed by an individual holding a child. He was walking downhill in the opposite direction. He is not aware where this person was heading. He only saw him as they passed each other. He assumed it was a father and daughter and thought nothing more of it. It must have been around 10 p.m. Martin Smith is known to have stated to the media that he and Robert Murat had, quote, "met several times." As we shall see in a moment, a key issue in our discussion of Smith Man will be Martin Smith's insistence, when interviewed by the Portuguese police on the 26th of May, that although he did not get a good view of the man he said he saw carrying a young child, he could be absolutely certain that the man he saw was not Robert Murat. The quote from the police files states, "He states that it is not possible to recognise the individual in person or by photograph. He, Smith, was not wearing glasses on this occasion." He adds that in May and August of 2006, he saw Robert Murat in Praia da Luz bars. On one of these occasions, he was inebriated and spoke to everyone. He also states that the individual who carried the child was not Robert. He would have recognised him immediately. Just for the record, here are statements I have found in the media and police files about this point. From his witness statement, in May and August 2006, he saw Robert Murat in Praia da Luz bars. On one of these occasions, the first, he was inebriated and spoke to everyone. From the Drogheda Independent, 8th of August 2007. The family are also mystified at reports that he knows Mr. Murat. They met once in a bar about 2 years ago. My dad would only know Mr. Murat by sight. On Sky News, 4th of January 2008, Martin Smith said, "I told police it was definitely not him because the man wasn't as big as Murat. I think I would have recognised him because I had met him several times previously." And finally, the Daily Mail, the 3rd of January 2008. Insisting he knew chief suspect Robert Murat visually for years, Mr. Smith told police the person he saw carrying a child could not be him. What we can say with certainty is that on the basis of these quotations, Martin Smith knew Robert Marat's appearance well enough to be sure, he maintains, that the man he saw wasn't Marat. There we must leave it. Except that his absolute insistence that the man he says he saw was not Robert Marat is one of many matters we now need to look at regarding his sighting. In doing so, I'm going to examine in depth all that we know about the sighting by the Smith family, using the witness statements made public by the Portuguese police, statements by the police themselves, newspaper reports about the sighting, and other evidence. To my knowledge, these issues have not been discussed in detail in our mainstream media. We need to do so because this sighting, according to a BBC Crime Watch programme shown in October 2013, was now absolutely central to Scotland Yard's investigation. As I mentioned, the first ever news of the Smith sighting came in an article in this local newspaper, the Drogheda Independent, on the 6th of June 2007, and 11 days after they were interviewed by the police in Portugal. The report told us, local family may have seen missing Maddie. A Drogheda family may have been the last people to see abducted 4-year-old Madeleine McCann in Portugal. The family is understood to have seen a child in the arms of a man on the night and at the time Madeleine was taken from her parents' apartment in Praia da Luz. They have reported the matter and recently gave statements to the Portuguese police. The Portuguese police have asked the family not to speak to the press in case they compromise their investigations. The family declined to give any details to the Drogheda Independent. It is not known who leaked this information to the Drogheda Independent. I will begin my examination of this sighting with an absolutely crucial aspect of it, that is, when Martin Smith and his family first told police about it. On the day Madeleine was reported missing by the McCanns, Martin Smith was holidaying at his holiday apartment in the Estra de Luz complex in Praia da Luz. With him were 8 other members of his family. His son Peter, his daughter-in-law Sheila and their 2 children aged 13 and 6, 2 other grandchildren aged 10 and 4, the children of his daughter Barbara. That made 9 of them altogether, 4 adults and 5 children. On the evening of the 3rd of May, Martin Smith and his family went out for a meal at the Dolphin restaurant in Praia da Luz. For some of the family, it was their last night in Praia da Luz. Peter and his family had booked their flight home the next morning. The police verified that the Smith family ate at the Dolphin restaurant that evening by finding the bill from the restaurant's till receipts. They finished their meal at about 9:30 p.m. that evening. Then they say they went to Kelly's bar for a drink on their way back to their apartment. An examination of the bar receipts for that night do not prove that they all went in for a drink. Only 4 receipts cover the period they were in Kelly's bar. None of the receipts show drinks bought for an entire family. The receipts are for perhaps 2 or 3 drinks. Unfortunately, the police do not seem to have asked the Smiths any questions about what drinks they ordered. On their own account, they were only there for a short time, maybe arriving at Kelly's bar around 9:35 p.m. and apparently leaving no more than 20 minutes later at around 9:55 p.m. The police checked out their story at Kelly's bar with the manager and his staff. A police statement said, "On the 10th of October at around 3 p.m. we went to Kelly's bar. We were received by an employee of the bar who had been on duty on the night of the 3rd of May 2007. When questioned whether she remembered the visit to the bar by witness Martin Smith and his family, she replied that she does not remember, given the lapse of time between the events and because the bar is daily frequented by dozens of clients of different nationalities." So there is some doubt about whether all of them stopped off for a drink at Kelly's bar that night. One thing that would have confirmed their story is the CCTV camera outside the Estrela de Luz complex. Unfortunately, by the time the police got to examine it, all the footage that night had been wiped. The Smith's account is of a man carrying a young blonde girl in pyjamas as the 9 members of the family were walking back to their apartment. Most of them say they remembered seeing him, although only 3 members that we know of made statements to the police. The Smiths say it was dark at the time they saw him, around 10 p.m. It was a cold, early May night, the temperature down to around 13 degrees centigrade. In the area where they saw him, the street lighting was weak. Each one glimpsed at him for a few seconds at the most as he walked past them. None of them say they got a clear view of his face. The 3 members of the family who made formal statements, Martin Smith, the grandfather, and his 2 children, Peter and Aoife, each told police that if they ever saw this man again, they would not be able to recognise him. These are important matters I will return to when we examine the claims that the Smiths, 1 year after their sighting, were apparently able to draw up these two e-fits of the man they say they saw, as shown by Detective Chief Inspector Andy Redwood on the BBC Crime Watch programme in October 2013. Their sighting must have been a memorable and fairly unusual sight. A man walking the streets of a small town, carrying an infant dressed only in pyjamas. No one with him, no buggy or pushchair, no coat or blanket covering the child. The following day in this village there was an international media storm. The whole of Praia da Luz and its surroundings were crawling with police officers, and hundreds of people from Praia da Luz and the surrounding villages were searching for Madeleine as well. The mainstream news media had clearly been tipped off very early that this was going to be a major story. Not only did Madeleine McCann become the top story at breakfast time the following day, but by lunchtime the world's media were descending on the small town in droves. By mid-morning, could anyone have been unaware that a three-year-old British girl was missing? Martin Smith, his wife, his daughter Aoife and two grandchildren stayed in Praia da Luz for a further week, while his son Peter and his family flew home to Ireland. The next day, 5th of May, just the same. Villagers, police, camera crews, journalists, everywhere. Madeleine was the top news item in Portugal, Britain, Ireland and all over the world. The police and the media were appealing for anyone with information to come forward. The Smith family had apparently seen a man carrying a blonde girl clad only in pyjamas late on the night in question. And days went by, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th of May. On Wednesday the 9th of May, Martin Smith and his family flew back to their home in Drogheda, Ireland. The 10th, the 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th and 15th went by. All this time, Madeleine remained top of the news on the TV and front pages of all the national newspapers in both Ireland and Britain. It wasn't until Wednesday the 16th of May, 13 days after Madeleine was reported missing, that the Smiths decided to report their sighting. So what was it, after 13 days of media frenzy, that prompted Martin Smith to contact the Irish police? Let us bear in mind that the one thing that Martin Smith was certain of when he made his formal statement to the police was that the man he claimed he'd seen for those fleeting few seconds was not Robert Murat. And why did he phone the police on that particular day, the 16th of May? Let's review what was happening to Robert Murat during this period. Murat is of English heritage but spent much of his early life in Portugal. He speaks fluent English and Portuguese. At the time the McCanns had their fateful holiday in Portugal, he was living part of the year in England and part in Portugal, where he had business interests. He had a young daughter in Norfolk, but was separated from his wife and going through a divorce. Whilst living in Norfolk, he acted as an official translator for Norfolk Police. On the day the McCanns began their holiday in Praia da Luz, Saturday the 28th of April 2007, Murat was staying with his sister in Devon, and, he says, renovating his grandmother's house. She had recently died. On Monday the 30th of April, just 2 days later, we know that he booked a ticket to fly to Portugal early the very next morning. According to Murat, he had been summoned to Portugal because he urgently needed to discuss his business affairs there. Murat had a girlfriend in Portugal, Michaela Walsuk. Her vision of events was that she had asked Murat to come over immediately because she was fed up waiting for Murat's divorce to come through. Had something happened the previous day, Sunday the 29th, which meant that he was urgently needed by someone? These are matters I hope to go into in depth in another film, focusing on the role of Robert Murat in this whole affair. In the event, in the early hours of Monday the 1st of May, his sister drove him to Exeter Airport. By 9:30 a.m. that morning, his plane had already touched down at Faro Airport. He then seems to have embarked on a round of meetings with Michaela, with his lawyer Francesco Pagaret, and with various business contacts and local people. On Friday the 4th of May, so he says, he woke up and learned from a passerby that a young British girl was missing. He immediately went up to the Ocean Club reception, spoke to the police and offered his services as a translator. His offer was readily accepted, given the sheer number of English people that the police now had to interview. And Murat was given the lead translating role, interpreting many important witness statements. But as he did so, suspicions about him grew. A journalist writing for The Mirror and The Independent, Laurie Campbell, is said to have spread rumours about him.
So I called Leicestershire Police back in the UK on Monday.
Why?
Because I was very suspicious about this man and his behaviour. Some of the stories that he was telling didn't ring true, his facts didn't add up. He was being very vague about his background, and he seemed far too interested and ready to give information to the media.
Campbell had previously worked closely with Clarence Mitchell, Tony Blair's top media manipulator, who was appointed by the government 3 days after Madeleine disappeared to be the McCann's public relations spokesman and reputation manager. Then Murat started exhibiting some strange behaviour whilst translating for the police. Let's look at some observations made by one of the police officers, Inspector Pedro Veranda, who worked on the Madeleine McCann investigation. He was so concerned about him that he wrote this report, to be found in the police's records of the inquiry. Let's just list the allegations made against Robert Murat. 1. Displaying an unusual curiosity about the investigation. 2. Insistently and repeatedly questioned me about the identity of possible suspects. 3. Insistently and repeatedly questioned me about the strategy outlined by the head of the investigation. 4. Insistently and repeatedly questioned me about the work that might possibly have been considered for the coming days. 5. Unusual and absolutely inappropriate behaviour. 6. Covertly trying to catch glimpses of various items being prepared for the case files. 7. Persistently trying to influence the conduct of the investigation. Inspector Veranda was also concerned that Murat manifested an enormous knowledge about the function of the Ocean Club and manifested enormous knowledge about the routines followed by the McCann family. The question that we might well ask about all this is, was this merely Murat's personal curiosity about the investigation, or was he acting on someone else's instructions? Following these developments, on Sunday the 13th of May, there was an informal police identity parade with Jane Tanner. The police put her in a police van with a two-way mirror and caused several people to walk by the van. Robert Murat was one of those who walked by. As Dr. Gonçalo Amaral says in his book, Jane Tanner was adamant. Robert Murat was the man she had seen carrying the child near the McCann's apartment 10 days earlier. As we may discuss in another film, Murat looked nothing like the man Tanner later sketched as the abductor. Later, Tanner admitted that she had been wrong to identify him. Not only did Jane Tanner insist that Murat was the abductor, but also MI5, the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Service, and criminal profilers for the British Security Services had been hard at work profiling Murat as the likely abductor. Now let's see how Gonçalo Amaral dealt with this issue in his book. He wrote, members of the British agency CEOP, Child Exploitation and Online Protection Centre, take a close interest in Murat and work to develop his psychological profile. The English specialists have continued to refine the profile of the suspect. There is a 90% chance that he is the guilty party. So it was that on Tuesday the 15th of May, on the basis of Tanner's insistence that Murat was the man with the child she'd seen on the evening of the 3rd of May, and on the basis of British intelligence officers saying that Murat fitted the likely profile of the abductor, the police pulled in Robert Murat for questioning. Immediately after his police interview, the police made Robert Murat the first formal suspect in the case. There was another media storm, with the press full of lurid stories which clearly implicated him as the likely abductor. Okay, so how does this fit in with the sighting by the Smith family? What is very curious is that for 13 days none of the Smith family appear to have done anything to contact the police about seeing a man carrying a child dressed only in pyjamas in the dark on the night Madeleine was reported missing. Yet, as far as we know, the very day after Murat is made a formal suspect, Martin Smith, for the first time, tells the police about his sighting. He then flies to Portugal 10 days later, the 26th of May, and is interviewed by the police, and one thing Smith is adamant about is that the man he saw was not Robert Murat. Is this timing just coincidence? This is how the investigation coordinator, Dr. Gonçalo Amaral, put it in his book. He wrote, the Smiths learn that, according to Jane Tanner's statements, Murat is definitely the man encountered on the night of the abduction. Mr. Smith then gets in touch with the Irish police to relate what he saw on the night of the 3rd of May. He insists categorically that the man they came across with the little girl in his arms was not Robert Murat. He is sure of it because he knows him. Let's examine why Martin Smith is said to have first contacted the police. The first story given by Martin Smith about why he had delayed so long was given in the Daily Mail in an article by Vanessa Allen on the 3rd of January 2008. Quote, "We were home 2 weeks when my son rang up and asked, was he dreaming? Or did we meet a man carrying a child the night Madeleine was taken? We all remembered that we had the same recollection. I felt we should report it to the police." Further on in the same report, we read this quote. Initially, the Smith family thought nothing more of the encounter, and even the next day when the story broke, they still didn't make the connection. "We were home 2 weeks when my son rang me up and asked, was he dreaming? Or did we meet a man carrying a child the night Madeleine was taken? We all remembered the same recollection, and I felt we should report it to the police," said Mr. Smith. The same story was given to the Drogheda Independent 6 days later, on the 9th of January 2008. This time Martin Smith's son, Peter, is quoted. He said, "It was only after we were home 2 weeks that I remembered seeing him. At the time, my attention was focused on looking after my wife. When I mentioned it, it jogged my father's memory, and he too remembered seeing the same man," Peter added. He went on, "We knew that what we had seen was so vague that we couldn't identify the guy." Pausing for a moment, let's bear this in mind as we proceed. What we had seen was so vague that we couldn't identify the guy. Madeleine's apparent abduction had been the top news story for 2 weeks. Neither Martin nor Peter Smith made any reference to the fact that it was on the day immediately following Murat being made a suspect that Peter started thinking about the man they'd seen 2 weeks earlier. Let's look at what he told the Portuguese police in his witness statement. He only became aware of Madeleine's disappearance the next morning from his daughter in Ireland. She had sent him a message or called him regarding what had happened. At this point, he thought that Madeleine could have been the child that he saw with the individual. Bear in mind, the townspeople and police were crawling all over Praia da Luz from the early hours of that first Friday morning looking for Madeleine. He tells the police that, on receiving this phone call from his daughter, he thought that Madeleine could have been the child he saw with the individual. So why, we must ask, did he not contact the police that very day, when the sighting should have been crystal clear in his mind? Why delay a whole 13 days? Now we'll move to the evidence of Peter Smith and examine what he says the reason for not contacting the police about their claimed sighting. It's in his statement to the police, quote, "He only found out about the disappearance of the child the next morning through someone he knew, the son of the builder of Estrela da Luz, who was also at the airport. At the time, he did not associate the said individual with the disappearance. Only after thinking on the subject and the coincidence of the time did he infer that Madeleine could have been the child carried by the individual that he had seen." This same account is also featured in the Drogheda Independent. In its edition of the 8th of August 2007, a family member, possibly Peter again, is quoted as saying, "We returned to Ireland the next day, and because the reported abduction times didn't originally match, we never had cause to examine their journey that night." The newspaper added, "As it emerged that Madeleine was abducted around the same time, one of the family members had a flashback of the moment some time later and encouraged the others to jog their memory. They remembered passing a man walking towards the beach with a child in his arms. Other than his approximate height and the fact that he was wearing beige clothes, they cannot be more specific than that." "We are annoyed at how vague our description is," said the family member. Once again, the family member states how vague our description is. Here is the same account, once again in The Sun, 3rd of January 2008. Their report reads, "The Smiths were leaving Kelly's Bar between 9:50 and 10 p.m. on May the 3rd last year. They flew home to Ireland the next day, but when the times of Maddie's abduction were revealed, the family remembered seeing a man, 5'7" to 5'9" tall, and dressed in beige, carrying a child. Significantly, the description matches that given by Jane Tanner, 37, a friend of the McCanns. And that leads to another reason the media claimed the Smiths contacted the police 13 days after Madeleine was reported missing. The claim that it was because their recollection of the man's clothing matched descriptions of his clothing given out in the press. This is how the Daily Mail reported the matter on the 3rd of January 2008. Their description of the barefoot child and the man, who wore beige trousers, echoes that of Miss Tanner. The coincidence prompted them to contact police after they returned to Ireland. Mr. Smith said, "Luz is such a small place and so quiet, we felt a duty to tell the police let them decide if it was important." So here we come up against a problem about the media's version of events. It is claimed they were prompted to contact the police because of one of two things. Either one, because they had heard that the time of the abduction was nearer to 10 p.m. than previously announced. Or two, because they had heard that the description of the clothing of the alleged abductor coincided with their own recollection. We have problems with both these claims, because when Martin Smith contacted the police in Drogheda on the 16th of May, no one knew about Jane Tanner and her description of the man she said she had seen. There had been no mention of it at all in the media. On the subject of the time of the alleged abduction, various times were given in the media during the initial storm. A Portuguese newspaper reflected the accepted view on its report of the 5th of May when it said that the abduction took place between 9 p.m. and 10 p.m. The Independent on the same day said, "But when Miss McCann, a GP, checked at 9:45 p.m, Madeleine, known to her family as Maddie, had gone." The Guardian the same day, quoting a cousin, said, "Mrs. Cameron said the couple checked on the children every half hour. The last check was made after 9 p.m. by Mr. McCann, sometime between then and around 10 p.m, when his wife walked into the room to find Madeleine missing. The family believes an intruder broke in and snatched the girl." Dozens of other reports said similar things. Madeleine was taken or abducted between 9 p.m. and 10 p.m. If the Smiths were not motivated to contact the police because of either of these two reasons, we can ask this question. Could the fact that they first contacted the police the day after a man they knew of was pulled in for questioning be significant? Why did Martin Smith make it clear in his statement he was absolutely certain the man was not Robert Murat? One problem we have is we can't be sure whether Smith was asked whether he thought the man could be Murat, or whether he volunteered the information without being asked. Here is the actual wording of the police report. In May and August of 2006, he saw Robert Murat in Praia da Luz bars. On one of these occasions, he was inebriated and spoke to everyone. He also states that the individual who carried the child was not Robert. He would have recognized him immediately. We should also bear in mind the quote from Gonçalo Amaral's book. The Smiths learn that, according to Jane Tanner's statements, Murat is definitely the man encountered on the night of the abduction. Mr. Smith then gets in touch with the Irish police to relate what he saw on the night of the 3rd of May. He insists categorically that the man they came across with the little girl in his arms was not Robert Murat. He is sure of this because he knows him. Despite the different reasons cited in the media for contacting the police that we discussed, Gonçalo Amaral's book seems to suggest a motive. I must make it clear here that I am not stating that this was Martin Smith's motive. I am just asking the question. At the time Martin Smith contacted the police, it was known publicly that Murat had just been made a suspect. But there was no mention publicly that anyone had been seen carrying a child. Only those close to the investigation at that time would have known about claims of a man carrying a child. And here's another question we need to consider. If someone had told him that Jane Tanner had identified Murat, could that person also have passed on to Martin Smith a copy of Jane Tanner's original description of the alleged abductor? That might account for the Smiths' description of the abductor being almost identical to Jane Tanner's, which we'll look at now. Again, I am not stating this as fact, I am asking questions. Earlier, I referred to a number of things the Smiths said about the man and child they saw. One family member said, "We are annoyed at how vague our description is." Peter Smith said, "It was so vague that we couldn't identify the man. They saw him in the dark with weak street lighting. They only saw him for a few seconds. He had his head down," according to at least one member of the family. Others said the child he was carrying meant you couldn't see his face properly. Bear in mind these statements when considering the details the Smith family, Martin, his son Peter, and his daughter Aoife, gave in Portimao Police Station on Saturday the 26th of May in their witness statements. Much of what they recalled of the man I am calling Smith Man matched the description of the man I am calling Tanner Man, the man Jane Tanner said she saw. The following 16 details were identical in each case. 1. In neither case could the man's face be seen. 2. He was an unaccompanied male. 3. He was carrying a child and had no buggy or pushchair. 4. The child was a girl. 5. The child was barefoot. 6. The child was wearing light-coloured stroke pink pyjamas. 7. She looked about 4 years old. 8. She was being held on the man's left side. 9. She didn't have a blanket or other covering. 10. The man didn't look like a tourist. 11. The man was wearing a dark jacket. 12. The man was wearing light-coloured trousers. 13. The man was about 1.75 metres to 1.8 metres tall, 5 foot 9 to 5 foot 10. 14. The man was aged about 30 to 40. 15. The man was of average build. 16. They were spotted within 600 yards of each other. When news of this second sighting of an abductor became known, there was much speculation about the identities of both Tanner Man and Smith Man. Some suggested that the descriptions were so close that it must be the same man. Others pointed out that according to Jane Tanner, she saw the man at 9:15 p.m., whereas the Smith Man sighting occurred around 10 p.m. They reasoned how unlikely it was that any abductor would be seen walking around for up to 45 minutes with a child they had just abducted. Most abductors, they said, would have made away rapidly in a car, assuming the abduction was planned. The uncanny similarity between the two descriptions, however, raises another awkward possibility. Namely, had the Smith family members not actually seen anyone at all, but merely copied from the description of Tanner Man? And again, I am not stating this as truth. I am stating it as a question. It might be a possibility based on the information we have available.